City Hall next.
Good afternoon, everyone. I want to welcome everyone to the City Council meeting of November the 19th. This is the afternoon agenda. Could I ask everyone to please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge of allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
City Clerk will take roll call, please.
Councilmember Barrera. Councilmember Castañeda. Councilmember Craig.
Here.
Councilmember De La Rosa.
Here.
Councilmember Lutz. Councilmember McShane.
Yes.
Mayor Gunter.
Here. Well, today is kind of a special day. Depending upon how you look at items, if you like art, if you like world classes, pieces of art, we're going to proclaim today, if we'll have Klaus come to the podium, we're going to claim this week as the Klaus Oldenburg and Kasi von Bruggen Hat Week, November 18th through the 23rd. I can see that we all forgot our hats today, but they're all out there in Sherwood Park, and they're rather large, except for my one councilwoman who actually went out and got two special shirts. Wow. Well, gentlemen, we've slipped. We should have brought our hats to the event. Okay. Whereas world-class renowned artist Klaus Oldenburg in visiting the Salinas Week of November 18th through the 2013 to supervise the reinstallation of the restored Hat in Three Stages of Landing, a public art sculpture first installed in 1982 at Sherwood Park. And whereas Salinas is proud to be a city with Klaus Oldenburg and Kasi von Bruggen sculpture called the Hat in Three Stages of Landing, and grateful that 30 years ago, a committee of residents decided to bring world-class art to Salinas. Whereas I, Mayor Joe Gunter, on the behalf of the City of Salinas, declare the week of November 18th through the 23rd as Hat Week and welcome Klaus Oldenburg and the Hats in Three Stages of Landing back to Salinas. If you could come to the podium, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay, don't run off. Council members, if we'll go down there and present him with his plaque,
it would be quite
the honor for us to do that. Jill, if you want to come join us.
He's going
to
say a few words.
Oh, is he going to say a few words? Or is he just
I don't know exactly what to say. This is the first time I've been in this position in my life. It's certainly the center of the room, and I'm standing in it. And what can I say except I can thank you very much for this, and I hope that this sculpture, which has been with us for quite a long time, has reached a point where its revival is assured. I'm very happy to go out there and see it, that it's in healthy condition and ready to go again. So thank you for everything, and I hope that I come back here and will continue to enjoy my visits to Salinas.
Thank you.
Thank you.
They are all good to shake your hand.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Oh, beautiful. Wow.
Aren't you coming for a big bear hug, huh? Oh.
Thank you.
We're lucky to have you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much.
So I can have this time.
Okay.
He got to.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Great. Wonderful. Well.
Sure. Just we can take a selfie.
That's good. Tweet it out, hashtag happy.
Yeah, I am. Ladies and gentlemen, before we start with our presentation, we received some rather sad news this morning. The mother of our city manager passed away, so if I could have a moment of silence, I would certainly appreciate that. Thank you. We will now go to a presentation from Monterey County on the Juvenile Hall Selection Site Update. And if Manny, the Chief Probation Officer for Monterey County, is going to do the presentation. Thank you, Manny.
Good morning, Mayor Gunter, members of the City Council. I'm Manuel Real, Chief Probation Officer, and here with Bob Murdoch, our Public Works Director, to talk about the new Juvenile Hall project and specifically the site selection. Juvenile Hall is a short-term detention facility for youngsters going through the juvenile court process, and the average stay is 20 to 30 days. It's a rather short term to get the whole process initiated. Our juvenile facility is over 15 years old and doesn't meet the current state of California requirements for a juvenile detention facility. We're basically grandfathered in because of its age. The original facility was built in the late 50s, and it had 72 single sleeping rooms, 12 of which were wet rooms. So wet room is a room that has the sink and toilet in it. So we're really short on those. In 1994, a 30-bed dorm was added, and then 5 years later, we converted the kitchen to add another 12-bed dorm, would bring the current state rated capacity up to 114 beds. We had some seismic damage and just general deterioration. So in 2003, in the spring, the major portion of the facility was shut down for about 16 months. The county committed about $4 million to the renovation of the facility. And we had our youngsters housed in four different facilities in three different counties. We had 48 of our kids in the CYA facility in Paso Robles. We had five youngsters in San Jose at Santa Clara County Juvenile Hall. And the 30-bed dorm remained open, but it was really a challenge for us over that 16-month period, and our staff covered over 300,000 miles transporting these youngsters back and forth from the CYA facility in Paso and from San Jose to our juvenile court and back pretty much on a daily basis. We had to make those round trips. So it was very challenging. We were very fortunate not to have had an accident or any major difficulties, but it was very challenging for us. As I mentioned, the total capacity for the juvenile hall right now is 114 beds, but we really have an inadequate facility. We have very inadequate medical space. We have very little confidential counseling offices for the attorneys that are visiting, for the probation officers, for our behavioral health staff that are on site in the juvenile hall, or for the providers that come to counsel our youngsters. We basically have one room on one of the units that's a converted washroom. We still have the pipes for the washing machine and dryer there. It is totally inadequate for our needs. And one of the things to me is most disturbing is our visitation is conducted in our gym. It has a linoleum floor. The families have to walk through the center of our facility to get into this loud gym. It's like an echo chamber in there for visitation. That's not the type of process that we want to get our youngsters back on track, start the rehabilitative process, and have them reintegrated back into their families. It's just sorely lacking. Now, we do the very best we can with what we have, but this facility needs a significant upgrade. And also, we don't have the space for the rehabilitative type of programs that we'd like to institute. We do have programs in the hall, and we do start the rehabilitative process while those youngsters are detained for that short time. But we need far better facilities. And our kids deserve better, quite frankly. The project that we're going forward with is funded by a conditional award of $35 million from the state of California. The grant was awarded to us in 2010, and since that time, we have asked for 3 one-year extensions on the site assurance. The funding for the county match wasn't available initially, and there have been a series of issues. Most recently, in January at our community meeting, we got a lot of indication that the site that we thought was the preferable site wasn't one that met with approval of a large number of folks from the city of Salinas. So we asked for an additional one-year extension, and we're now involved in the process to determine that site selection. That's what this is all about. If those grant funds are not used for this specific purpose, for this new juvenile detention facility, that $35 million would revert back to the state of California and would go to another county. It cannot be used for any other purpose than for this site, the juvenile detention facility that we've applied for. The grant would fund the design, the construction, and the renovation of this new juvenile facility. The proposed new juvenile hall would have a capacity of 150 beds. It would have the ADA accessibility, and it would have space for all those areas that I mentioned were so deficient in: medical services, the family visitation, the confidential interviewing, attorney interview rooms, inner room for the probation officers to work with their youngsters while they're in the incarceration, and then for the rehabilitative programs. One of the things that was quite apparent to us when we did the three community meetings, and then your council held its own fourth meeting, was that folks are real concerned about the programs that are offered to the youngsters. They don't simply want young people just locked up, put into custody, and that's our program. And what we talked about at length is the whole series of services that we have in the juvenile justice arena. And we really are very fortunate in this community to have a wide array of very strong alternatives to detention and strong rehabilitative programs for our justice-involved youngsters. So I have some of those listed up here. The juvenile hall is one portion of the juvenile justice continuum of services. That's the detention part, but there's a whole lot more than goes into our services. And it would start with the Silver Star Resource Center, which is a multi-agency collaborative. It truly is a model one-stop shop of services to pre-delinquent youngsters. The focus and effort there is to keep youngsters from migrating into the justice system. It's targeting at-risk youngsters. Many of the referrals come from the schools or from the district attorney's truancy program. But we have behavioral health, social services, probation is there, the DA's truancy program. We have an on-site school through the Monterey County Office of Education's alternative ed program. We have Second Chance, Canada for New Youth Outreach, Partners for Peace does a Strengthening Families program. It's just a whole host of programs in a one-stop shop trying to divert youngsters from going into the juvenile justice system. That's our effort, that's our focus. And we feel very strongly about that program, to where we have committed resources to other areas of our departments, the DA, social services, probation, behavioral health, to make sure that that program is operational. We originally started with a federal earmark sponsored by Congressman Farr. When that earmark concluded, we found ways to keep it going because we feel so strongly in these type of prevention, early intervention type services. I better go faster, I won't get through my list. We have intake diversion. Any youngster that's arrested, either given a juvenile citation or booked into juvenile hall, is referred to probation. More than 55% of the youngsters that are referred to us in any given year are diverted out of the system. They either go to the restorative justice programs, they go to community service work, we have theft defenders, substance abuse programs, or we have a short abeyance caseload, we call it, where we'll supervise youngsters for a very brief period of time, and then we close their case. And we have a very high success rate with those youngsters. They are the lower level offenders, but fully 55% of our kids, or more, it's about 57% last year, do not go on to juvenile court. For those youngsters that do have a more serious offense or have repeated offenses and then go on to court, a lion's share of those are supervised under our campus-based probation officer program. That's most of the youngsters remain at home in the community going to school, and we supervise them in a partnership with our local high school districts. We also have a juvenile drug treatment court program. We have a juvenile mental health court program. We have a juvenile sex offender response team for young sex offenders. We treat them here in our community rather than removing them from parental custody and then sending them out of county. And we know all the research and data indicates that we are far more successful treating them locally than we are removing them from custody and sending them away. I think we're one of the few counties in the state of California with such a team, and again, that's in close collaboration with behavioral health. We have a placement intervention program for the youngsters that have significant problems. The judge cuts an order to remove them from parental custody, but we give them one last try at home under this very small caseload, very tightly structured program. We also have wraparound services. Again, a very similar population, kids that are very troubled, but we provide them with a whole array of services to keep them at home in the community, and we've had great outcomes with that. We work with the County Office of Education in the community school for youngsters that are expelled from their local high school districts. And we have them in the school with probation staff and probation aides to support them in their educational needs. We have the day reporting center at Rancho. We have 60 youngsters in that structured, supervised all-day program. We pick the youngsters up from their home in the morning, take them to Rancho. They get breakfast, they go to school for 4 hours in the morning, feed them lunch, and then they go to a whole host of programs in the afternoon, whether they're pre-employment skill training, anger management, substance abuse, the whole litany of programs, and then later on in the afternoon we take them home. So those youngsters in a structured, supervised program all day long. We also have an evening reporting center at Rancho for the youngsters that are in violation of their probation. Rather than hooking them up and putting them in custody and then filing a juvenile court petition, we make an agreement with them. If you work with us for the next couple of months, every day after school we'll pick you up, you go to Rancho. We have tutoring, mentoring, we have the recreational services there. They have dinner with us, and then about 8:30, we take them home. So they're out of harm's way for that period of time where kids more often than not get into trouble, that after school 3:30 to 8 o'clock time frame. So all of these interventions are very, very important and cover the whole host of kids that that we supervise. As I mentioned, juvenile hall is not a treatment facility. It's a short-term detention facility. Nonetheless, it is the most opportune time to start our intervention programs. It's our linkage with behavioral health and service providers starts the rehabilitative program while we have these youngsters in juvenile hall. So we have here a list of programs that are offered in juvenile hall. While I say it's a short-term detention program, we do have some youngsters there for, you know, very long stays. Those youngsters that are facing adult charges, the 17-year-olds, almost 18-year-old that have committed serious violent offenses, possibly a murder, attempted murder, serious violence. And now they're facing adult court charges. We'll stay with us for a year or up to almost 2 years. So we don't have a high number, but there's, 10 to 15 youngsters that fall into that category. So we have a whole host of programs there. The one I would like to highlight is the Juvenile Offender Community Health Services Program. That's something we started about 4 years ago with funding from a grantor at the state level, and it's a re-entry program to get the youngsters connected with the health clinics, with behavioral health, social services, and make sure that they return to their schools very quickly after they're released from the hall. In years past, there was often a large gap between the time they would be released from the hall until the time they entered back into school. So we are, feel very good about that, and as well as the other programs that we have listed there. Our youth center is a long-term treatment facility. Youngsters are generally there about 9 months. We have a wonderful on-site school through the County Office of Education. And I really think that's one of the strengths of probation's approach is our collaborative relationships with all our partners, with behavioral health, with the County Office of Education, with the local high school districts. We really do work very well together. And we have a great school at the Youth Center, and there's a whole host of programs. Another just outstanding program we have is the vocational pre-apprenticeship program. It's called the Paxton-Patterson program. We have about 7 different stages where the youngsters learn plumbing, tile setting, framing, bricklaying. There's 7 different curriculums that they go through, and if they finish those and do well and are motivated, then they can apply for an apprenticeship program upon graduation. So Take the Lead program from the SPCA is another great program where the dogs are brought over with SPCA and our youngsters work with them to help them to be adoptable. These are pets that are not ready to be adopted. And then we have a strong presence from behavioral health at the youth center that provides services. We have an officer that works in the aftercare program so that these youngsters can transcend back into the community. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Bob Murdoch, and he can talk to you about our site selection matrix.
Good evening, Mayor, Council members. My name is Bob Murdoch. I'm the Director of Public Works for Monterey County, and I'm going to talk to you about the site selection process that's underway right now to find a site for the new juvenile hall. Now, before I go into the process, I want to say that about a year ago, county staff came forward with a recommendation to use a site next to the county's corporation yard on Laurel, the East Laurel site. It's actually 855 East Laurel. And we got a significant amount of concern from the public about the site, that it wasn't the appropriate site for a juvenile hall. So that caused county staff to take a step back, reassess what we were doing, and actually put together a more lengthy process to try to identify more appropriate sites, get community input, and then ultimately identify an appropriate site, all keeping in mind that the state grant deadline is we have to go to the state with a preferred site in March of 2014 or risk losing the $35 million. So here is the process that we developed. So it started with, in August, we tried to identify as many sites as possible in the county that would be appropriate for a juvenile hall. In addition, we developed a number of ranking criteria to try to help us understand how these sites rate against each other. So in order to identify sites, we went back and we looked at sites that had been proposed for probation in the past. We had sites proposed to us by developers, as well as sites identified by county staff. Ultimately, we identified 11 sites, and this is a map showing all 11 locations. One is in Marina, one is in Seaside, six are in the city of Salinas, and three are in the unincorporated areas of the county. Now, I'd like to note that as part of the outreach effort, one thing that we asked for during the public comment was, if you had another site that is not listed here, please bring it to the county staff and we would take a look at it. Over the four public meetings that we attended, not one additional site was proposed. So these are the 11 sites we started with, and these are the 11 sites we have right now. Now, as part of the process, we tried to develop criteria to help us compare the 11 sites amongst themselves. Criteria such as, what's the current zoning of the site? Does the county already own the site? Does it have utilities? Does it have water and sewer? Does it have a road? Is it adjacent or relatively close to the existing juvenile court, hospital services, food services? How difficult is it to build on the site? As well as, would a facility at that particular location cause an increase in operating costs? So each of these criteria were given a score and a rating, and ultimately we developed a ranking of the 11 sites against each other. Now, I'm sorry, this is a little bit difficult to read, but actually the site that ranked the highest furthest on the left was the existing juvenile hall site. Now, what we've told people in the public meetings is this is not intended to identify the preferred site. This is only intended to give us a relative understanding of how the sites rank against each other based on the criteria. Really, to identify a preferred site, we needed to take this information and go to the public and get public input, right? You can't just use a ranking. You have to get public input and try to put those two together to identify a preferred site. So we've actually participated in four public meetings so far, all in October, are the 15th, 17th, 23rd, and the 30th. Now, we went out, we had boards for all 11 sites, showed the location, had information about the scoring criteria, we had information about the existing site and the need for the new site and the funding for the site. So we've gone through the public workshops, and we are now in November, and we're taking the information that we received from the public along with our ranking criteria and trying to come together on and preparing a site assessment. And ultimately what we're going to do is we're going to go to the Board of Supervisors in January with all of this information and with the goal of identifying a preferred site in January. In order to get to the state board on March 5th, we need a resolution from the Board of Supervisors in January in order to package that together, submit it in February to the board to get on their agenda to meet their deadline. If we fail to do that, we risk losing the $35 million grant. So that concludes our presentation. Be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much. We're going to go to my right, to Councilwoman De La Rosa.
I have a quick question for Manny. Manny, can you tell us why some of these juveniles have to be sent out of county, like to Visalia and Dinuba?
That's generally because I have a specific issue that we don't have the resources or programs within our county. That's out of home care. We don't have many residential treatment programs, non-custodial treatment programs within Monterey County. We have one, Door to Hope, is for young ladies. It's a Santa Lucia program. But beyond that, we don't have many programs within our county that have specifically would be like a sexual abuse treatment program, a serious substance abuse treatment type program. We don't have those in county.
So can I ask you, how much is it cost? Is it the cost to send someone out to another county, approximately? How much are we having?
You know, $5,000 to $7,000 per kid per month.
And they stay for how many months?
Oftentimes, 9 months to a year.
Okay. All right.
We have about 50 to 55 youngsters in out-of-home care right now. If you look back about 10 years, we would be closer to 100. Mm-hmm. Similar to our Division of Juvenile Justice, the old California Youth Authority, mm-hmm. We have 14 youngsters there presently. If you look back just a few years, we had over 100. If you look at our juvenile hall, we have about 65 kids in there as of today, where in just 4 or 5 years ago, we were, you know, having a hard time staying under 120. The number of youngsters that are being referred to us for handling has significantly gone down. So while we're dealing with serious violent crime in our community, and obviously that is of great concern, the overall juvenile crime rate is going down, the youngsters in detention is going down, and the youngsters that we have in out-of-home care is going down. So of all those programs that I mentioned, I think we're having some success.
Okay, and I have one last question. I'm going to mention the youth center on Circle. When that was first built, we were told that it started out like a boot camp, kind of, that's what we were told, that it was going to be set up like a boot camp. When did that change, you know, that?
The boot camp orientation?
Yeah.
Probably, I don't know, 6, 7 years ago. All the scientific research and evidence indicates that a boot camp absent of a treatment program is not an effective intervention.
Okay.
And we wanted to go with the best practices, and so we have modeled our program after what they call the Missouri model. It's a small dorm setting where the youngsters are in school, in treatment, and the like, and they move through that program together. All the research indicates that's more effective.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's my questions. Thank you.
Councilmember Barrera.
Chief Riel, welcome. And I appreciate your empathy for the families that go through this process. Chief Riel, at Juvenile Hall, how many youngsters do we have right now?
65.
Right now?
Today.
Out of those 65, how much are they charged for homicide?
That I don't know. Jose Ramirez is our juvenile hall director.
Just a ballpark on them. I think there's currently 4 for homicide and 5 for attempted murder.
So to some degree, these are long-term till whenever their case is. How about at the 9-month youth center on Circle, how many students do we have right now?
I believe we have 45 or 48. Today.
You know, and I appreciate your good work because I think you and your staff are really trying to do the best, what's in the best interest of our community. When I spoke to you, you said that both programs, the youth center and the juvenile hall, difficult to coexist. Can you tell me why, or tell us why, please?
Yes, juvenile hall, as I mentioned, is a short-term detention facility. The youth center is a long-term treatment facility, so we have many more programs and services provided to the youngsters at the youth center. One is a juvenile detention facility. One is considered a camp or ranch, so the funding streams from the state are different and segregated.
But even though the funding streams are different, with the right type of building, would it be possible to have both programs, even though they may be in the same building, but separate in the process of intervention? Is it possible?
It might be able to be on the same piece of land, but it has to be distinct and different programs. They have to be separated. They can't join.
Absolutely. But what I'm saying, separated. Okay, so you got this beautiful building. if the structure is right, the facility, the infrastructure, even though they're separate, could they coexist within the same area?
If they were separated, suspect, I'm not sure on that. I guess they could. We would have to check with the state and see what their parameters are about the proximity of those two types of facilities. I can give you an example. We had the girls program, the Santa Lucia Bay, at the youth center some years ago, and the state said that program is, it's a residential treatment program. It cannot exist on the youth center's campus. Consequently, we had to move it out, and fortunately, Door to Hope stepped up and provided the services. So I'm not certain on the answer to your question.
Do you think, I'll save it for comments, but do you think it would be very difficult to find out if that is possible? I mean, later on, if I call you in a couple of weeks?
Sure.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Councilmember Councilwoman Lutz.
Just a quick question, Manny, and I appreciate your presentation, and you may not have the answer to this one, but is the county looking at all at that entire property? You know, we look at that old hospital that needs seismic retrofitting, tearing it down maybe, or just really looking at a real general plan for that whole area, which would then incorporate both the juvenile hall and the county program on Circle. Do you know of any master planning that's being done?
Not to my knowledge. I know that the hospital has needs for expansion. And when we had talked about expanding into the old Nativity Hospital site previously, there was discussion that they needed that area for their expansion. So I don't know the answer to that.
Okay. It just seems to me that there should be some kind of master planning, but nonetheless, thank you.
Councilmember Castaneda.
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Chief, for the presentation. If you go back to the sites, I don't know if you can go to the sites as far as the slide, if you may, please. There's 11 overall sites, and I believe Mr. Murdoch mentioned, or yourself, if we had additional sites to mention those as of today. I don't think we can go ahead and start mentioning more particular sites until we honestly have more of an inventory of what the county owns, similar to what the city also owns. Can you provide that information to this council as far as an inventory of county-owned properties, whether you have Pebble Beach, Carmel, Monterey on the list, sure. South County and so forth?
Sure. Councilmember, yes, we do have an inventory of sites. Okay. We'd be more than happy to provide it.
So, and as of now, we're looking at, and just so we're clear on this, you also, the Monterey County Probation Department, or yourself, Chief, also operate the youth center.
Yes.
100%. And you roughly average about 45 to 48 youth. And I know the total capacity in the new, or excuse me, the older juvenile hall, that's about 114 beds. That's the total capacity?
Yes.
But how many youth are in there? Is it 114 as well?
Today it's 65.
Currently?
Today.
Okay. And the new one that we're looking at that you want to build is more of an expansion.
Yes.
Because we already have two existing facilities that you operate. So this is an expansion that we're talking about.
Well, it would replace the existing juvenile hall.
Okay. Because I recall the previous meetings that we had, and going back to the very first meeting, I know that we were looking at a presentation from your staff and from yourself. I believe Councilmember Tony Barrera also attended, as well as some other community members. At that time, it was the Laurel facility that we were looking at. The Laurel facility, my understanding, does have some ownership from the county.
Yes.
And I believe there's some high school district regional occupational programs there as well as some other shared facilities. But this council has looked at goals and objectives of looking at some soccer fields. I don't know if you were aware of that. And then recently, this council also approved multi-housing units through Creek Bridge Development, which is going to be within that vicinity as well. Does that impact the decision of this facility that received a proposed location from your office? Does that change anything?
Yes, that's why we're going through this process right now. That's why we asked for a year's extension to identify alternative sites. The biggest change that has occurred, quite frankly, is when we put this application in was in 2008. At that time, the existing juvenile hall site was encumbered, meaning it was used as collateral for some other project that the county had funded. And the requirements for the state is for an unencumbered site. The Laurel Yard site was one of the few unencumbered sites that was in close proximity to the juvenile court, to the county hospital, to all the essential services that we needed. Mm-hmm. So that's why we went forward with that site. But seeing that there was a significant concern, including the soccer field issues and other things, we have requested this extension. In June, the existing juvenile site was unencumbered. So when we started on this process probably 8-9 years ago, we thought we would be building on the existing site. When we learned through this grant application that it was not available to us, we had to come up with an alternative. Well, now as of this past June, it is now back available for us to build on that existing site. So now it's back into the mix. That's probably the biggest change that has occurred in the last year.
Okay, so that's what has happened from back then to now.
Yes.
And the county is gonna, what's their share of this total facilities? Is it about $17 million or so?
Yes.
Okay, and the state's gonna be pitching in $35 million. That's been approved in 2010.
Correct, it's a conditional award. We have to meet certain conditions to get that.
Okay. Can your staff work with our city staff? Is that an option as well that you're open to in regards to negotiations? If you look at, because out of the 11 sites, we have 6 sites that are being proposed within the city of Salinas. And if I can ask you more directly, most likely you want to build in the city the new expansion 150-bed facility. Is that where your recommendation is leading to? What would you recommend today if we had the Board of Supervisor meeting resolution to be presented in January? Do you want to build here in Salinas?
We don't have a recommendation right now. So, you know, just quite directly, we just don't. We just finished with the community input. We're assembling that together along with the pros and cons of each site, and we're trying to figure that out right now. So we really can't answer your question, unfortunately.
So if there is no recommendation, it's still a draft, a work in progress then. That's what I understand, which is good. Are you open then to work with our city staff? I know our city manager is not here today. We have our assistant city manager, our city attorney, working with your staff as well to negotiate and look at. We did this previously with another organization that's looking to facilitate or manage one of our city-owned properties. And then we adopt as a council a resolution to have them negotiate the terms. And obviously, that's up to us in time frames, whether it's 30 days, 45, 60 days. But it looks like we still have time from here to January to work together in regards to where is the county going to go with this. Because right now, it doesn't look like the percentages and the odds are really are not in the city's favor. It looks like you are gonna pretty much wanna have a facility here, regardless if we have an open draft that we're speaking of. And out of the 6, how many are they located in the LSL area?
Is 312 East LSL considered in the LSL area, the old public works yard? Pretty close to my office. I don't know exactly where you draw the line.
And then there's one, I think, at the other than soccer fields.
That's the Laurel Yard site.
And then there's the other facility. No, that's the East LSL was a different one. This one's on the Laurel. And I believe you have another one, and correct me if I'm wrong, but by the airport, south of the airport as well.
Yes.
Okay. My last question is, your policy for visitation, what's your policy for families to visit the youth in your facilities?
I'm going to ask Mr. Maris to answer that.
As far as who could visit, is that what your question is?
Right. How does it work for visitation? Because I know during the presentations, there was a visitation room that was shown in pictures, yeah. And I believe that it was a very minimal amount of visitation for the families. And I think that was one of the justifications of keeping a facility within the city, to have families visit their youth, their loved ones, the children.
So our visitation policy is they're allowed 2 hours a week, of course, with the exception of perhaps special visits and whatnot. So we hold three visitations, two on Saturday, one on Sunday, and they go for about 2 hours. We also have special visitation for certain kids where the parents work, say, on the weekends, and they're only available in the middle of the week to come in and actually do, you know, visit their children. We also have a 24-hour visiting. So if the kid gets arrested within the first 24 hours, they're allowed a 15-minute visit. So it's immediate family members that actually come in and visit. So it could be mom, dad, and sometimes, you know, we allow grandparents to come in. Okay. So if it's one child, it could be up to four people in there.
And as far as the community stakeholder group, that was also mentioned in your presentation. Is that something that is active, or you're planning to initiate a community stakeholder group within this city or within the county?
I'm not familiar. I'm not sure what you're referring
to. That was mentioned.
Did I mention that?
It was in the program. Retract that. It was within the presentations when you started going down the list of programs. I believe that was something that was mentioned from yourself or one of the other presenters, but it was mentioned that we have an opportunity to have community stakeholders participate on these programs to show the success of these programs. In other words, there was a high efficiency and effectiveness of these programs, and that could be viewed by community stakeholders if we wanted to appoint people, Councilmember Barrera and Councilmember De La Rosa and myself, or even this council overall.
We have a juvenile justice commission that oversees the juvenile justice programs, does the inspection at juvenile hall, conducts the inspection at the youth center, and all detention facilities for young people in the county of Monterey. So that would be the appropriate group. As I said, it's a juvenile justice commission. It's in statute. Members are appointed by the juvenile court. We also have evaluations of our program, if that's what you're referring to, under our Juvenile Justice Crime Prevention Act. We have evaluations of the, say, Rancho-Shello program, our drug court program, a whole variety of the programs, and we have that going back about 10 years, so they can speak to the effectiveness of these various approaches.
The Juvenile Justice Commission, is that a group that you appoint, or that's appointed by a different body?
It's appointed by the juvenile court judge. And it's the oversight body for juvenile justice in Monterey County. And as I said, it does the inspections for the youth center, the juvenile hall, any local police departments that have detention of youngsters, or any residential treatment programs. There's also a juvenile justice coordinating council that oversees the funding for the Juvenile Justice Crime Prevention Act programs. That's a much larger group.
Mm-hmm. As far as consolidation, I know the La Paz, if you go to the dates, this Councilmember Barrera De La Rosa, myself, mentioned this was previously, it was La Paz Middle School, and then we decided to host a meeting on the 30th at the Cesar Chavez Library. Within that decision, it was later known that we seen, I believe it was an email from Ms. Carroll, I believe she's here, Maya Carroll. It was another meeting that you, well, excuse me, it was a La Paz meeting. Was that La Paz meeting originally scheduled? Because I know originally that there was only two advertised to the community or the public, the one in the peninsula and the previous one to that, which was at the old hospital in Salinas. So La Paz Middle School, was that part of that, or was that triggered because we were going to host another meeting ourselves?
Originally, we talked about having three meetings, and as part of the process went along, we decided we would have the initial two meetings, see what kind of feedback we got, and then if we felt appropriate, have a third meeting. At the first meeting, we had a lot of feedback that the site of the first meeting was not conducive to the community coming and engaging and being there. Okay. And as a result of that, because the site selected for the first meeting was problematic, we decided to have the third one. We decided that evening. You were there, Councilmember Barrera, Councilmember Del Rosa were all there, and were vocal that you didn't care for the site that we had selected. And so that was the reason for the third meeting.
Okay. Thank you for sharing that. That's it for me, Mayor.
Councilmember McShane.
Yeah, given that the site's going to be an expansion over current facility, what's the shelf life?
No, it won't be an expansion. It'll be a replacement. It'll be an instead of.
Replacement, let's say enhancement. Sorry, wrong word. What's the shelf life plan for the new facility? 20 years, 30 years, 100 years? What are we building to?
The existing facility's been there over 50 years, so I would imagine this new facility would be a 50-year-plus facility.
Okay. And your timeline, are you pretty optimistic? I mean, you think we're going to get there by March? Is it a cold and prickly reception thus far, or warm and embracing?
I don't know. It's lukewarm, I guess.
Okay. But you feel the timeline's reasonable?
The timeline would be, if we get a site assurance by March, we'll probably take a year or so to do the environmental impact, and that'll be further opportunities for community input, suggestions, alternatives, and the like.
Wow.
Then it'll be about another close to a year for the design, architectural drawings and all that, and then probably a couple more years to build it. So that's being optimistic, I'm told. I'm not a builder. You know, Mr. Murdoch could tell you better than I, but that's what I'm understanding.
Yeah, thanks. That's all.
Councilwoman Craig. Manny, can you tell me how many of these youth that are in these two facilities are from Salinas? Approximately.
I don't know right now, but historically it's been about 60%.
Okay. My next question is, if and when we build this facility, the county has the policy that they try to use local builders and that kind of thing, so that this $52 million would come into this community, because obviously we're going to build a juvenile hall somewhere. So it would come to... There would be people from Salinas, possibly, that would have these contracts?
Yes, that has been a board directive, that we use local contractors.
Okay. Now we're going to go to the audience, but I want to remind everybody that this is a juvenile site update, and I would hope to remind my council when we have comments that that's all that this is. So the podium will be open for 2 minutes of comment on the juvenile hall.
Hello, my name is Ana Barrera. I am a resident of Salinas. And my comment is that, you know, this is something that we do not want in our community. You get offered something that is going to bring out a message to our community. You're speaking to our community about what we represent for this city of Salinas. And when you talk about institutionalizing our youth, that message is clear. This is how you'll treat the rest of our community, is, you know, by using criminalization of Salinas. I really want you to stop back and think, you know, what are you bringing into your city? You know, you're speaking hope, or are you speaking opportunities for our kids, our youth? I wanted to be here since the beginning, but, you know, I was speaking to parents, working with youth this afternoon, you know, trying to find alternatives for our kids. And to me, it's something that you really need to start thinking about what the city is about. I've been here for a couple of years, and I want this to be my home. I want this to be the place where I'm raising my child. But the type of things that I see happening at this city, the types of things that you bring into the city, you know, you have so much access to revenue and income that you could be bringing in positive things, things that bring rehabilitation, that bring services. So, you know, as you're looking at your program and you're going to bring it, and that's your mission, is to bring things like this, you know, bring things that bring mental health to our kids, you know, services to our children, youth, you know, bring services that will address the needs of our gente, you know, speak to the corazón of our communities. You know, you're addressing who are being housed in these communities. It's raza, it's Mexican Americans. You know, you want to talk about the issues of crime? You know, are you bringing in programs that are culturally relevant? Are you bringing in programs and services to these kids that are dealing with addictions, that are dealing with no jobs, no resources? You know, start looking for programs that are like Rancho Cielo, that, you know, are giving kids opportunities and hope. And I stop now? That's my buzzer? Okay, thank you very much.
Seeing no one else, we'll now go back to the council members for comment. I'll go to Councilwoman De La Rosa.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I would like to see this council and our staff, Manny, the county staff, continue this dialogue, okay? Because it's affecting, like you can see, and you've heard the comments, we had the meetings, our constituents on the sites. And I don't want it to end, I want it to continue. So if we could have a resolution to continue the dialogue, we need to work together with you, the county. And my comments are also is that, you know, we're a community and we have to work together. Yes, nobody wants to build any more jails or juvenile halls, but we have to, you know, Ms. Barrera, your comments, we need to bring together a committee, Manny, that is very diversified, that it's not just this juvenile justice, but it's also community. Some of the community can come together because we have parents out there that have their children in juvenile hall that we need to hear them. What are some of the needs that they are seeing? And I think we need to work with those parents also, not just this other committee, which, you know, it's okay, but you need to hear the community, the community from the rest of our city, not just them. But again, I remind everyone, unfortunately, some of our children are committing crimes and nobody wants to build these facilities. But right now, the conditions of that facility, I have gone in there as a county employee and I'm telling you, it's deplorable for these children that are there. So again, we need to think what can we do to make it better? And we need to work as a community and we need to hear the community. So those are my recommendations. And you know, let's continue to have the dialogue and hear our, you know, the city of Salinas, which is our staff, to work with you. But I'll tell everybody, the Laurel site, that is out for a lot of us here. Okay, so that's it.
Councilmember Barrera.
Did you hear that, Chief? It's out. That was our future Mayor Pro Tem there. I think if anybody is I have a lot of respect for our probation chief. Manny Real, I think, has more empathy for these families that it's a difficult job to see young people incarcerated and looking for solutions on how we can improve families' lives. We have 9 young people under the age of 18 that are there for charged for homicide. That's a serious thing. Not that they've been convicted, but they've been charged. I've been at the juvenile hall as a volunteer for several years now, off and on. And I'll try to be as specific and quickly as possible, but the probation department had one of the most fantastic programs where they brought La Familia in, las abuelitas, grandmas. I would see the hugs, the kisses, Nana. The grandmas were there as volunteers. I mean, such a beautiful sight to see these young people, these young ladies that were incarcerated to hug one of the abuelitas as they're being taught how to knit. But you know, sad to say, las abuelitas had to stop because some of those young people started manipulating those kind-hearted senior citizens. I saw that myself. I think Mr. Real has tried different things and I think you are working as much where these young people, even though they're behind bars, they're getting a second chance, which is called intervention. I will ask you, whatever the decision is, because I'm a strong advocate of prevention. You know, I just got back from a conference, a junket conference, that the best workshops that I attended were from high school commissioners. All the adults were looking for ways of how to deal with their gang violence. Millions of dollars this county, we spend millions of dollars on intervention, putting out a fire here when there's another one over there. But you know the high school kids? They had some of the best workshops. You know why? Because they were looking at preventive measures. How can I save my little brother, my little sister from not seeing juvenile hall? But to progress as teenagers. Chief Rial, I think there's an opportunity right now. With your wisdom and your staff, if you can get that youth center, which is over on Circle, and somehow build this building wherever it is, maybe in Pebble Beach by Spanish Bay, preferably. In your wisdom, sir, we can use that facility at the youth center, that incarcerated facility, to use it as one of the programs. Months ago, you sent me a program that you've invested in a lot of time into it. And I've studied it, and you know what? It's great on prevention. And I think if we work together, we can have a win-win situation where the kids can have a facility, because I'm gonna make it known now, the Church of the Nazarene Church, we're not gonna give it back to Governor Brown, we're gonna keep it, because our children need facilities. I know management will tell us we can't do it, but Councilmember Lutz already told me we're gonna keep it, so I trust her. So for everybody here, to share with you, there are some of our young citizens that for some reason or another choose not to participate in our law-abiding society. The great hope is that those that are incarcerated, they have people like Mr. Rial that are there for a second chance. If you heard him speak, he's looking for solutions. He's looking for families where moms don't have to go too far to visit their son or their daughter. I'm against incarceration. But my experience has been there's some, a small sector of our community chooses not to be part of our society. And we have to put them in a safe place, not only for them, but for good citizens. Thank you, Mr. Dial.
Councilwoman Craig.
Certainly understanding that there is quite a bit of passion coming from this council. I'm pleased that we have three council members, any more than three, and you have a city council meeting in your hands, but three council members who have taken an incredible interest and are actively participating. One of the things that I would just note, and I thank you for the update and the comprehensive update. Some of us allow, you know, other council members to take the lead in certain areas. I'm your transportation girl. Certainly, Councilman Castaneda, Barrera, and De La Rosa have taken on juvenile hall. Understanding that in order to move things forward, it's always, you know, it, whatever topic that we talk about between the county and the cities, whether it be transportation or water or the Solid Waste Authority or ambulance services, ultimately what we have to do is compromise and work together on it. And so I really appreciate the update. It was incredibly educational for me. And I'm sitting here, Tony's committed to taking me around town to learn more about it. That being said, thank you.
Councilwoman Lutz.
Thank you again for the presentation, Manny. It was very interesting. Just a reminder that that is in my district, and we are, of course, watching very carefully about where it's going to go. I think it's really important that we mention, and Gloria brought this up, we don't like to, and I think Tony did also, we don't like to talk about prisons or jails or juvenile detention centers or juvenile hall. But the sad fact is, this United States has the highest documented incarceration rate in the world. We have 5% of the world's population and over 25% of the world's prisoners, which means that every place in America has to put up with building prisons. That's just the way it is. So having said that, let me say from the representative in this district, I think that the site that it's currently at is a good choice. I think it works well. It has for the last 50 years. And I realize that Creek Bridge especially was built after the jail was put in, after the prison was, the juvenile hall was put in, but they've still managed to coexist well. And so I think that that's a, the existing site is a good choice. But I'm also gonna say this, that $35 million can only go towards building this juvenile facility. And do I want it to go to the schools? Of course I do. Do I want it to go to behavioral health programs and mental health programs and other health programs? Of course I do, but it can't. And $35 million is a great investment in this community. And I think that as long as we keep kids, youth, in facilities like we have them in now, we're really making real clear that message that they are throwaway children, because we're putting them into facilities that are deteriorating, and dilapidated. And the message that we send to children, our youth, is we don't want you back. We want to put you in this kind of a facility. And if we spend $35 million to get a nice facility for our youth, then we can start giving these young people the message that they are valued people and they do need to come back to our society as valuable working adults. So I hope that this goes smoothly. I hope you get the money. I hope you work well with the city in terms of making the final decision and with my district. And I appreciate, Manny, everything you've done. You've been a real crusader on this. You've been a champion for our incarcerated youth, and I appreciate what you've done. So let's continue to work hand in hand on this. Thank you.
Councilmember Castaneda.
Thank you, Mayor. Just for clarification, we're done with public comments?
Yes, we've moved on from public comments.
Okay. As far as myself, I'm not afraid to let it be known that of my true thoughts, and I think I've been very upfront with you, Chief. I don't want to see a juvenile hall in this city whatsoever, whether it's South Salinas, North Salinas, West Salinas, or East Salinas. It's just, I think we have so many goals and objectives here that we need to focus on those to come to fruition first. I do understand your pressing situation of this deplorable juvenile hall, which I don't fully agree. I do see a juvenile hall that is in operating condition. If it was that horrendous or deplorable, then it would be condemned, where it would not be operating whatsoever. There is facilities that are older than 50 years in the city that are very well maintained still. So I think the county, that's a different discussion to have in regards to the maintenance of this. There's 12 to 13 other cities in this county. Again, 6 out of the 11 are in this city. I do like the idea that Councilmember Gloria De La Rosa brought up, looking at a resolution so we can go ahead and push forward. So if that was a motion, that was something that we can look at for the future. I know it's a presentation for today, but at least it opens up the dialogue between the city and the county. My mistake is that I know too much. And what I do know, what I'll be willing to share, is that there's a lot of politics in this as well. And that's a round circle, the dog chasing its tail, from the judges to the political contributions and so forth, even of the building of this new juvenile hall, because it's going to be within this county of who's going to be selected, which we kind of know where it's going to go, are the same ones that contribute to these candidates, and they run the systems, whether it's schools, community colleges, county office of education, and cities, and so forth. It's been like that for the longest time. I think if we, it's just something that's very difficult at this time for us, but if we stay uniformed on the decision here, I think at this time it's premature. I wouldn't share where our position is at right now, just because I think consolidation is something that you really need to look at, Chief. The consolidation of the youth center, which, by the way, I don't recall, and I'm pretty active in the community in the last 15, 18 years or so. I don't recall that youth center ever asking the community, even the clinic next to it, and the residents and the businesses that we're gonna go ahead and operate here. I just don't recall that whatsoever. It was just implanted there, and we have to live with that decision. I do like this conversation now that we're having the dialogue, and I want to go ahead and make sure that we continue opening the dialogue. Although I do feel this way, it's just my personal thoughts, my personal feelings to this. Definitely the Laurel or any other site in the city of Salinas I would not support, but it doesn't mean that the discussions cannot happen between the city staff and the county staff. I would just hope that we look at all possibilities and not close ourselves just to this city because of other rationales that we may use, such as services. So let's continue our dialogue, Chief, and I do appreciate your openness as well, and thank you for sharing more information with us today.
Councilmember McShane.
Well, I love community meetings, and I applaud my colleagues for the community meeting that took place. It was well engaged, very, very valuable, I'm sure. And while I think there's at least one colleague of mine that might want to nudge me for this, I love the County of Monterey. What I love most about the County of Monterey is that they are here in the city limits of Salinas. They have lunch here, they hang out after work, maybe take their spouse out to dinner, and the possibility of a $35 million investment for a program that seems to have done pretty well. If business is down for Manny and his team, then that means that the kind of partnerships and the scrapping that you've had to do in a day and age when government's had to be really lean was working. So I think with plenty of community meetings and engagement, we might be able to find something that works. I'll lend myself as it is necessary. I look to my colleagues that have already dived in face first. I don't think it should go in Spanish Bay. I mean, if you look at 60% here in Salinas, approximately, and take into consideration the Salinas Valley and loved ones from King City, Gonzales, Greenfield that have to drive all the way to Pebble Beach to visit their loved ones, that just doesn't seem right to me. So I think you're headed in the right direction. Whatever you need from me, let me know, and continue to work and play here in the city limits of Salinas. Thank you.
Manny Gonzales, Manny Real, and I see Rosemary Centeno's here from the These are folks that are involved in the Community Alliance and Safety and Peace in the city of Salinas that have been working very diligently trying to keep our young people out of juvenile hall, which is kind of a unique position for the probation department to be in, because most probation officers I've met in other counties brag about how many people they can arrest. Manny's trying to brag to us about how many he can put back on the street that are doing good things in the community through the facility he has. So I want to thank all three of you and your public works director for being here today and providing us with the input. So thank you very much, and I'm sure we'll be hearing more on this facility.
Thank you.
Thank you. This ends the presentation report. We are now going to go to public comment. It's limited to 2 minutes, or it can be less, determining how many people are going to speak. Just to remind everybody, this is not a sporting event. We will not jeer. We will not be rude or impolite to other people and their opinions. We would hope that we will conduct ourselves in a professional manner. We will now open for public comment on anything that is not on the current agenda.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, council members. I'm Bill Ritz, district representative for Senator Anthony Cannella. I just dropped by this evening to bring to your attention that the senator is having a health care town hall on December 5th from 6 to 7 p.m. at La Paz Middle School. And it's going to be in conjunction with Covered California. So there's going to be a lot of information going forth in that meeting on December 5th. I'll be happy to leave these flyers with you. You can contact me with any information that any more information I can give you. I did leave flyers for the public out front. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ritz.
My name's Michael Corlett. I'm a resident of Salinas lifelong. My mother's family moved here 110 years ago. I'm a licensed accountant and been practicing here for 33 years. I'm here to talk about Municipal Auditing Services, LLC. Some of you seem to have heard of them before. I guess if the city thought that the police department was understaffed, would they hire an independent contractor called Dirty Harry Enterprises and give Dirty Harry a bounty for every body he felt like shooting? Well, in the business community, that's what you have here. And so to misquote the mayor by taking something out of context written by Jeff Mitchell, if these reports are true, no, I'm taking it out of context. I'm quoting Jeff. If these reports are true, this is not what I want let me get this right. This is not the way I want the city doing business. Well, it is true. And I'm going to give you an extreme example, and it's true. I have a client, a widow in her 80s, confined to a wheelchair, recently diagnosed with cancer, who owns an empty, unrented lot. Let me repeat that, an empty, unrented lot. And these people, your friends who you hired, MAS, they're telling me that according to their records and the law, she's conducting business. Give me a break. Give me a break. I mean, words can't, I go beyond the 2 minutes here, but I'll just say it's unethical, illegal, harassment, just plain wrong. So I saw on the city's website that the contract with municipal auditing services can be terminated for any reason within 30 days. Do it. Do it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening. My name is Laura Cabrera, and I'm here with Assemblymember Alejo. Just to let the public know, of small businesses, that the Assemblymember is hosting a Build Your Business and Job Creator series in, here in Salinas Valley. The coming up work is three workshops. One workshop is the Facebook workshop, which is going to be taking place this Friday, and I know the city is partnering up with us. It's from 11:30 to 1. It's free for any business. Just sign up at our website. And the second workshop is called Go Biz. So this is utilizing state programs. This is December 3rd, 10:30 to 12. And then the third one is the California Lottery, which is a lottery retail benefits, which is in December 11 from 5 to 7. So we'd love to have all businesses who are interested here in Salinas to come in, mingle and learn about how to make their business better. So I'll have some flyers. I know Joe Gunter, also the mayor, has flyers. So just visit our website for more information. Thank you.
Thank you.
It's almost Christmas. Hi, my name is Lupe Covarrubias Martinez, and I'm the secretary for the Cultural Committee of Salinas. And I'm here to actually say thank you to the city for helping sponsor El Grito Festival and Parade that we had on September 14th and 15th of this year. Through this festival, we had approximately 30,000 people that attended, all residents from throughout Monterey County, and the best part is most of them were from Salinas. So the other good thing that this is the second year that the committee has sponsored the event. This year we were able to give back approximately, not much, but at least 3,500 back to two school groups that came to raise money at the event. We had over 50 students who did high school community service hours, and we had, and that was from all the high schools in Salinas. And so a big chunk of them, though, were from Salinas High and Everett Alvarez. But then we did have a group from Alisal High School that came and was one of the groups that was able to make money. And then we also had a children's area, and the good thing about it was that we had our city library that was there. We had kind of like a mini city of Salinas. So we had somebody from the Parks and Recs department, from the library, and several other agencies that provided the residents with information about the services that were available. And so as a quick little thank you before my time is up, I brought you all a commemorative t-shirt from our event, and I'll leave them here so afterwards you guys can come pick them up. But thank you so much again for sponsoring, and we invite you to our next event, which will be a posada. And last year we gave out 800 toys to children. It'll be December 14th. It's a Saturday at 3:00 at Cluster Park, and you're all welcome to come. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Leticia Hernandez, and I am a resident of District 1. I am interested in starting a community garden in Natividad Park. I believe our city can really benefit from a community garden. Some of the ways it can benefit are by stimulating social interaction, providing a catalyst for neighborhood and community development, encouraging families to become self-reliant, reducing family food budgets, conserving resources, providing opportunities for recreation, exercise, therapy, and education, as well as an opportunity for intergenerational and cross-cultural connections. I was hoping to partner with the city. I did get to speak with Jose Castaneda this morning about go ahead, brainstorming some ideas and getting the ball rolling. So he does have my contact information as if you guys need to get a hold of me or go ahead and send me your ideas. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll have someone from our Parks Department get a hold of you, young lady. Thank you.
Hello, hi, good evening. Steve Rosales again. I'm here to express my own thanks for the outpouring of help to Typhoon Kailan in the worldwide terms. But Yolanda in the Philippines, whoever gave donations, I'm really touched by outpouring from all over the world. And personally, I am not representing nobody. I'm just by myself. I'm going to say thank you to everybody.
Thank you, sir.
Ray DeLow, 150 Kern Street. I got up this morning and my wife had fixed me breakfast and I got my cup of coffee and I got the Californian out and almost had a heart attack. I read the dome and actually agreed with Mr. Mitchell. It was, I tell you, you know, that you change your whole world when that happens to you. If I happened to be in Kansas City on Thursday, and so I got on the internet to find out what we were going to be talking about today. And I couldn't find everything that you were going to be talking about. And the real key thing that you were going to be talking about, I could not find. And I couldn't find the information. I don't think that's fair to your citizens that you do not allow us the time to look at the things that you're going to want and you ask for public comment on. And you don't give us the information so that we can look at it and digest it and give you a good, honest public comment on that. So I was very disappointed, and I hope that this is not something that continues in the future, but that when these huge items are going to be coming up onto the agenda, that you would do us, the citizens, the honor of giving us that information ahead of time so that we can look at it and read it. I go so far as to go down through the financial report and see how much you spend on your junkets. So, and how many, yeah, in Kansas City I can do that. And that's the beauty of having the internet. So I just encourage that you do that in the future. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon. My name is Al Espindola. I just wanted to make an announcement that on Wednesday at 4 p.m., Measure VE is having its public meeting. If you're interested in seeing how the money is being spent and how we process it through the Oversight Committee, it's an opportunity to come in and watch us at do our job. And this is a whole new year coming up, and I know the city's strapped for cash, and we have a lot of needs. And sometimes hearing from the public helps us in making our recommendations to you, the council. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Seeing no one else, we are closing public comment. I am now going to council member reports, appointments, and future agenda items, and I will go to Councilwoman De La Rosa.
I just want to thank the staff, and I want to thank Chispa for the Wesley Oaks project on the corner of Carr and Fremont. If you have the opportunity to go down, you know, we have construction going on and right now, but I have to tell you, we had the ribbon cutting for nine. They look like they are townhouses, but I have to tell you, it was a very emotional moment for me because that area was so blighted on that corner, and I know Councilmember Barrera and the others that passed by there. It was very emotional because right before Christmas, and we, in this city, we don't have enough affordable housing, and especially when we know that some of our residents are doubled up, tripled up in some of our homes right now, or even living in garages. So if you have the opportunity, it's right off of Market Street on the corner of Carr and Fremont. Beautiful, beautiful condos. They look like, Mayor, you were there. They look like kind of Victorian or something like that. They are. And I want to thank the architect. I want to thank the architect and just Chispa and our city staff for what a beautiful, beautiful project. And also, I just want to make a comment that, you know, there's so many meetings going on that are happening in the city, and we want to inform the public. But I have to tell you, it was kind of disappointed. And I don't know what happened. And I want to take it back to the Solid Waste Authority that we had a community meeting while some of you were gone to Seattle. And there was another meeting going on with the mayor and Councilmember McShane. I came to City Hall for a meeting on the Solid Waste Authority, and let me tell you, there was no community members that showed up. So my comments are to them, you need to have another meeting. And you have to make sure that it's publicized on all the websites, that it's publicized in the media, because no one came. Okay, so that's one. And the other thing is that there's so much need right now. We need to help the Salvation Army for what's happening in the Philippines, their Christmas giveaway, turkey baskets, Dorothy's Kitchen. Let's see, just in general, there's so much need in our community. And I ask you, every little bit counts. And to really think about giving a little bit to everyone, that would help. In Hebron Heights, next Monday, we're going to be giving out 25 food baskets for Thanksgiving, 25 turkeys. And there's other agencies and other that are doing other things in the city. So again, if you can give, I encourage you to give a little bit to everyone. And those are my comments. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Barrera.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Mr. Mayor, first of all, we wanted to just say, I wanted to thank Councilmember Lutz and myself. We went to the hospital to be with our city manager, and like you said, we just found out she went to be with the Lord. So it's thinking about our city manager right now. Also, I'd like to thank California Water, Mr. Mike Jones, for several years now, a great partner not only of the city of Salinas, but throughout Monterey County. And I understand even Senator Canela is going to be giving out 100 turkeys. Wow. Thanks to the great work of California Water, where families will have the dignity of getting a nice box of groceries and just have a great time with their families. So California Water, thank you very much for that. It means a lot. I think I went to a revival this last week. I was surrounded by high school youth commissioners of different cities throughout the U.S. of A. talking on prevention. I went to some wonderful meetings as well with some of my colleagues throughout the nation talking about gang violence. I mean, that's the buzzword. But you know what these young people were saying? What is it that we can be involved in policy decision making to show people such as CASP and others, you know what, if we're going to invest millions of dollars on intervention, on crime and other serious issues, why not just throw a few thousand dollars on prevention? That way these children, we will not see them in 10 years in juvenile hall, but we will see them being consistent and good citizens in our community. Man, these kids are on fire. And you know what, Mayor and colleagues, we have a youth commission here, and I know we some of them are, we appoint them, but I feel as one council member, I feel very disconnected because they're doing great work, and sometimes we're not aware of that. I think we need to make our high school students part of the decision making. Did you know that our young people, the other city council, our youth commissioners, they're getting ready to have some holiday parties at the bread box? I remember maybe there was 100, maybe 200 students. Not one single fight. And you know why? Because the kids themselves were the ones monitoring the facility. It was a great event. But did it make it in the dome? No. What makes it in the dome? It's a soap opera, but thanks to the pastor, he enjoyed it this time around. So, but you know, there's a lot of great things happening in our community. And I just want to say, you know, Wesley Oaks just welcomed 10 families. One of the things that we need in Salinas is, like the mayor just said, homes almost like Pebble Beach. All they need is the gate. But now there's going to be children in those families that have a little backyard, you know, where they can be safe with their families and have some green space. I don't know if you folks know this, but Councilmember De La Rosa, one of our senior citizen complexes, called Los Abuelos, is named after her. Legacy, La Gloria Apartments. It's a beautiful state-of-the-art complex. So I would like to thank her. I got this in the newspaper, and my favorite newspaper, The Californian. And I wanted to share this with you folks.
I didn't even see that.
Yeah.
I did it.
Pass it around, but give it back to Sister Gloria, okay? Oh. And then the other thing is, I don't know if you folks know that a couple of weeks ago, Councilmember Craig here was chosen as one of the 25 Monterey County Weekly superstars to watch for the next 25 years. Yes. And it says here, Councilmember Craig, she's a rising politician with big plans for Salinas economic development. Well, Councilmember Craig, this is an awesome. I'm going to pass it around. I hope they don't keep this, but I cut this out from the Monterey County Weekly, and I wanted you to have it. No, it's a great honor. Thank you very much. Pásalo para allá. Thank you, Mayor.
Rising star, it's your turn.
I don't know if rising politician is a good terminology, but I liked the last sentence because it rang true, and it was, dude, I just want to help my city. That's all I'm here for. So thank you very much for the words, kind words, Tony. I appreciate you, although I will say that going after you is sort of like going after the pastor in church a little bit. There's a lot of, you know, passion. So I'll be brief with my updates. Wanted to note that we had our executive meeting for the Transportation Agency of Monterey County. And part of the agenda that we talked about were the STIP funds. STIP stands for State Transportation Improvement Program. And the reason why that is valid and important for our city is that they have recently shifted those funds to give us the remaining $5 million for the rail extension down to Salinas. So that was an update, and the project scenarios involved there. The city of Salinas and the train station there remains a priority, which is great. When you're talking about dealing with 17 cities and a county, you know, there are a lot of people that have a lot of different ideas and a lot of agendas, and for everybody to be in unison, in agreement, for the city of Salinas to be first up on that is fantastic. So I continue to move that forward on behalf of the city. Secondly, to Assemblymember Alejo's office, I will be attending that Facebook small business seminar. I thought that was a great opportunity. It's free, and I think she noted it was from 11:30 to 1 at the Steinbeck Center. So you'll see me there. I'm going to be in the K. Craig Media hat, not the councilwoman hat, so I'm hoping to learn a little bit on that end. Additionally, Veterans Day, we had an incredible showing of support for our Veterans Day parade. I almost feel like I should not be in the parade. I serve my country in a different manner. I serve my city in a different manner. But certainly, just the outpouring of support and even from the residents, it was. I would venture to say a bigger turnout than the Parade of Lights or the Como del Rodeo parade. So it was a. I think that we should do everything in our power necessary to continue that parade. It is multi-city, and we are fortunate to have it here in the city of Salinas. So Also, I do have one request for the city manager or the acting city manager, Jim, and I do believe I have one, maybe two buddies on this. I have two buddies on this request. I'm going to go ahead in honor of Art Fest and Hat Week. I'm going to also make a request that we receive a strategic plan that is developed and implemented for fundraising for the Yellow Hats. So like to see how we are going to engage the community in participating in our project with fine art in our city. And lastly, I just want to make a note, and this is more for the people at home that are watching, the Salvation Army, who were the recipients of the turkeys from California Water, are also doing a Thanksgiving Day feast, and so they welcome everyone from the public. I'll probably be down there for a brief bit. But just they have open arms, open doors, and anyone is welcome. On Thanksgiving Day, that's the Salvation Army, which is not the Salvation Army store on North Main, but rather the Salvation headquarters, Salvation Army headquarters at the corner of Russell and North Main Street. And that's all. Thank you.
Councilwoman Lutz.
Thank you, Mayor. I'm going to try to keep this short, but I have a lot to say. And I will, it was all in good fun. I know when Tony and others brought up the junket to the National League of Cities in Seattle. But it really, we need to look very seriously at when the council, when we go for training. Several years ago, I remember going to a meeting where they said, woe to the cities who have cut their training budgets. It's going to come back and bite you. And it has. It certainly has in the city. It's affected us throughout in every single department. When we go to places like the National League of Cities, what we're really doing is we're looking at the best practices and the best ideas from cities across the nation. The director of Public Works from Seattle said, I love it and hate it when my council members go off to the National League of Cities because they come back with such great ideas, and of course they turn to staff and say, staff, can you implement these great ideas? And I see Gary shaking his head and saying, yeah, I already had a talk with Gary about some of the things I brought back. But you know what, let me also say this, that this is a chance for us to develop and build our knowledge. And whether it's for economic development, public safety, infrastructure, or even just leadership, this is critical for our cities. When anytime anyone goes away for training, it comes back and it really benefits our city multifold. One of the things that I was most impressed at, and one of the things I really want to bring home to council and the city, is that when we work with the National League of Cities, we're really working in a very strategic partnership. What we're finding is that, and the National League of Cities is doing a lot of strategic team building, because we need to become, the local level, need to become very powerful partners with our state and our federal partners in elected offices, because that's where really the needs of the municipalities are met, is right here. And so we can talk about a federal level, but the fact is, if the cities ain't happy, nobody's happy. So we really need to figure out, especially now as we're in a post-recession, a brand new post-recession economic reality. Our technology is changing at a furious pace. We have, in the United States now, the most diverse population in the history of this country. We're seeing a major generational shift in power, and we're also working in a political climate that's gridlocked and polarized. So how do we then become effective at getting services and policies to meet the needs of the residents at all the levels of municipalities in the United States? So what the National League of Cities is doing is they're driving federal policy on behalf of cities that directly influence the residents. They are promoting innovation and proven strategies to bring valuable resources to us as electeds so that we can give those resources to our constituents. And they're raising the profile of local governments to improve the quality of life throughout the United States. That in itself is so valuable when we go and we meet with the local leaders from across the nation, and we're looking at those best practices, and we're finding ways to influence the policymakers at the federal and state level, because it comes back to make our city stronger. Just very quickly, a couple of the classes that I attended, I went to the mobile vending along with my two colleagues. What was fascinating about the mobile vending, and Mayor, if we ever start updating our regulations, we always talk about ways that the mobile vendors are hurting the community or hurting the businesses, especially the brick and mortar. Well, what we learned, really, looking again across the nation, that there's a lot of positives to mobile vending, to our mobile vendors. You know, we can attract culinary talent. It's the eyes and ears of our street. It adds vitality to our neighborhoods. It supports urban gardens. Most importantly for Salinas, it brings fresh produce to food desert neighborhoods. So I really want us to look at our mobile vendors and update those regulations and see how we can work in better partnership and make them more effective. It's worked well in Portland, in Seattle, and a number of places, Cleveland, throughout the United States, and I think we can do just as well. The other thing is, I did take a tour of a MRF facility, that is the material recovery facility in Seattle. We have one here in Marina. In Seattle, it's the second, I think it's the largest one on the West Coast. They take 750 tons of recyclables daily and sell it to the domestic and international markets. Something that I think we need to look more into. The other program that I went to that I really enjoyed was something called Shifting Expectations for Neighborhoods and Transitions. It was led by the Deputy Secretary for Housing and Urban Development, Ron Sims, and it really struck a chord for us. It's the economic crisis exposed really the fragility of our already vulnerable neighborhoods. And so the shifting public expectations, the social and economic transitions, and the demographic changes are really going to impact us in terms of our planning and community development. So it's something that we want to really be on top of as we discuss the crisis and the demands that are placed on cities to create stronger, greener, and more sustainable neighborhoods. So that was very important. There were a couple other programs that were just as good, but I just wanted to close with at least for my report, with talking with a few vendors that are really promoting fully accessible play structures. And Gary and Al, if you're still here, there's a in El Dorado Park, there's a broken slide. It's not only incredibly dangerous, but it's very unsightly. And I think we should think about replacing those kind of structures with fully accessible structures. Now that we have Tatum's Garden, I think that we need to start thinking about all the needs of our diverse communities and see how we can get some of those. They don't seem like they're any more expensive than, and I gave you, Gary, a booklet, a couple of booklets from two different vendors about fully accessible structures. Okay, two things then. Also California Water. I too want to thank California Water for the turkeys. We got 25 certificates for children in my school that are really struggling with poverty, and it was very cute to see one little first grader come to the office to get his turkey and was handed the certificate in an envelope, and he looked at it and he said, "But where's the turkey?" So anyway, it was wonderful, though, because these are families that certainly can't afford a turkey at Thanksgiving. Okay, two quick things, and I think I have backups on both of these. Tony, two more, but very quick. Tony seconded this idea, is that I'd like to revisit the tax incentive policy that we have for new businesses, especially now that the future growth area is going forward. I want us to relook at that and see how valuable it has been for our city and what it's doing for us. And then the last thing would be really very concerned about the cleanup. Gary, you and I talked about it. I think that at this point, I hope we could have somehow maybe an emergency session. An emergency meeting, not session, but I think that there's too many people that are going to be displaced in the cleanup that's coming up on the 21st. People are scared, people are anxious, and they are already under stress. And I hope that we can reconsider that sweep or at least delay it until we can really get some safeguards put into place so we can protect people and their belongings during this time.
Second.
Thank you, Mayor.
So I'll second the first and the second one for Councilwoman Jewel Lutz. Thank you. So I want to reiterate what she talked about already. Although we do want to look at the overwhelming information we received through economic development, there is potential of having brick and mortar restaurants working with mobile vendors as well. It's the concept of everyone playing within the same sandbox, and that is possible. So we can look at that for more policy and looking at what committee that would take precedence, and then from there bringing it back to the council. I'm looking for the seconds on some of these updates. Thank you, Patricia, our city clerk. You sent us a calendar of upcoming agenda items, future reports, and so forth. One of them that I did not see, and maybe I overlooked at the list, but I just wanted to go ahead and follow up on the senior commission. I believe Council Member Steve McShane seconded that. We buddied up together, and that was a senior citizens commission, aside from the other commissions that we have on the list. Another report that I want to follow up, Mayor, and there was the Finance Committee. My understanding that the Finance Committee has received information in regards to Second Chance being a fiscal agent, the City of Salinas being a fiscal agent, fiscal agent for the Second Chance group. It's been mentioned before in public comments, it's been mentioned before by council members, and from my understanding, there was a formal presentation given to the Finance Committee, and I was looking forward for that to come to this council if that's what took place. Looking at the municipal auditing services, I know our city manager's out with a dire emergency. Wanted to do not only the follow-up on that, but I think it's time to bring it back to the council and just to go ahead and look at the language of that, Mayor. So if you can look at our busy calendar and see if that fits within the next couple of agenda items or so, just to look at municipal auditing services. Councilmember Steve McShane and I have mentioned that as a buddy item. And I think it's to a point where are we going to continue hearing more complaints on it, or are we going to seriously consider maybe even the cease or desist temporarily until we get this resolved with the municipal auditing services? Community gardens, do I have a second on community gardens? I think that's what we were going to look at. If the possibility of if it had a low impact to our budget as well. So it's going to be something feasible. And by the way, I know the Cesar Chavez Library is asking for our input, so I believe Councilmember De La Rosa, Councilmember Tony Barrera, and myself will be looking at not only within amongst us, but also with other constituents in there to give more input. So that may be another avenue that we can look at. But community gardens is something that we want to bring forward to this council for a future agenda item. I have zero appointments at this time, Patricia. As far as council member reports, as you know, we attended the conference. I think it's very crucial to continue the partnership at that level with the National League of Cities for many reasons. Regardless of the cost, I think it's very minimal compared to the overwhelming information that we receive that can make a major impact in the city of Salinas. One of those items, which I will go ahead and bring more information to this council, happens to be with the city of Sunnyvale. City of Sunnyvale is a similar population to our city, and they have significant savings in public safety. We're looking at possibly getting a good amount of savings for this city budget as we continue our budget discussions. So I'd like to go ahead and speak to the mayor more of a council member that I met out there, as well as the city of Sunnyvale and what they're doing because of his public safety background. And for reports, I will be attending Patricia for Councilmember Steve McShane and the Monterey Air District, Air Pollution District meeting for tomorrow. Thank you.
I'll echo Councilmember Castaneda's comments with regards to the list of future presentations on the agenda. Hopefully people are paying attention to that. Two things. One thing, if you can, Patty, add the date that the item was requested. I think it's important to measure if it's, you know, taken 3, 6, 12, 14 months to get a hold of somebody that's going to give a presentation. And with regards to presentations not agendized per city manager, I didn't realize there's two on there that kind of got kicked to the curb. So I'd love to follow up. I think the policy is if we have a buddy, it gets agendized. So I never was contacted on those. So if you, please, Jim, could relate to Ray that a friendly phone call on the agenda items that got kicked to the curb would be great. Yeah, there's two listed on the back of the agenda.
Where are they?
I want to start by certainly saying happy holidays as Thanksgiving's coming up. The Advent calendar for my colleagues, it's just a really a symbol of friendship. You know, we're in this because I think last we checked, we just want to help the city. So, you know, I just want to really keep the spirit alive there. And certainly to Mike and Cal Water as well. You guys do so much for this community, and what you've done, the gesture with the turkeys for those less fortunate are to be really acknowledged as well. Last week had a community meeting with the mayor. I'm sure he might have a few comments, but just to be certain, there were 45 folks, and that's about as many people as are in the rotunda right now, including the children in the back and, you know, the folks taking notes and such. Five clearly identified with the special tax, 20 fresh faces. The mayor and I looked at each other. First Presbyterian Church hosted it, and it was the first time that they'd done something like that. And the fresh faces were great. I think walking out of there, public safety certainly came up, and there's some a little louder about that than others. But more than anything, I really took away an interest in families, things to do here in Salinas, keeping kids busy so they stay off the street. And to the Salinas Valley Solid Waste Authority, it's a pity that there was a meeting scheduled the same night. I literally found out about it the same day, and I couldn't even get a flyer. It was, you know, no harm, no foul on them. I just hope that it can be rescheduled. And you know what I can do with a community meeting. You let me know if you need a partner, sister. Okay, just saying. I had a very interesting conversation with the lady that runs TAMPSE, she provided a survey that is really interesting. I guess TAMPSE funded a survey looking at regional needs for transportation infrastructure, public safety. I forwarded it on to my colleagues. I don't know if you had a chance to check it out, either in electronic or print form. For those of the media or anybody else in the public that has a keen interest on just surveys, as I'm sure we'll hear soon about a survey that the city funded, it's a real interesting look-see. No doubt about it. And one thing she said, and I looked to my colleague that's the transportation contact, she said something like, you guys get 2014, we get 2016. So there is a TAMPSE tax coming. I don't know. I'm looking for it to be confirmed, but that's what she told me. So let the rumor begin here. I'm anxious to find out kind of where that's at. A couple Sundays ago, my colleague, Councilman Castaneda, and I went to the Old Town Retreat, sixth floor of the Rabobank building. Old Town has big plans. I'll tell you, it's red hot and rolling, and I look forward to seeing them to fruition. Also, the Salinas Neighborhood Council, tomorrow night, this room, 6 o'clock, Partners for Peace. There'll be a presentation from their executive director on families, kids. 6 o'clock. There's also an effort to raise money for the neighborhood council, and I know I passed it on to some of the colleagues, and I hope you guys will consider from your council accounts supporting the neighborhood council. I think it's a worthwhile cause. Few other things while I'm at it. This coming Tuesday, the mayor and I hope some of the other colleagues will be present in Old Town for the lighting of what we like to call the Salinas holiday tree, ribbons of peace tied on there. Old Town, Salvation Army, PG&E is doing LED lights this year. The elementary school district will be providing a little choir. It should be very nice. Interesting AMBAG meeting. You know, Councilwoman Lutz prepared me for a very interesting topic of regional housing. Regional housing needs allocation, and that's really Santa Cruz County and Monterey County. She said, beware, because Santa Cruz County is going to want to assess or assign some of the required housing to Salinas. So I went in there, guns a-blazing. It was a hot meeting. We didn't have a meeting for December. We do now. And I have for all of the colleagues to check out everything that I picked up from this meeting. And for anybody that is interested in kind of inter-county strife, this is where I think there was a court case going a few years back. Thank you, really, Councilwoman Lutz, for preparing me on that. I went and checked with Supervisor Salinas, and he's like, yeah, hold your ground. So just it's going to be interesting. What I'm handing out there just speaks to really an interest in regional planning where people live where they work. Enough said. On the 8th of December, I'm going to have a holiday mixer at my home with the Neighborhood Council and my neighbors, and I'd like to invite you as colleagues. So I just want to say to you guys, you're welcome. I'd love to spend some time with you. I'll pass out an invitation. Last but not least, I am thrilled by all the activities this week, too. Elizabeth Martinez and the rest of the city staff that have gotten behind public art with what Klaus is bringing back to Salinas. I'm really excited, so it's gonna be great. All right, that's enough. Thank you.
Councilman Craig, Woman Craig, you have one more item.
Just a point of clarification from Councilman McShane, and certainly recognizing the conversation. I want to squelch rumors on any type of component. We are dealing, when you talk about transportation, you're talking about how to fund hundreds of millions of dollars worth of projects. One of those projects that I've sort of been discussing and giving updates to is the widening of Highway 156. And there is some real discussion over whether or not do you put a toll booth
yes.
on Highway 156? Do you tax the residents? Do you exempt the residents? And so in those discussions of all of these different ways to how do you fund that so that our hospitality industry on the Monterey Peninsula continues to thrive, recognizing that that also benefits the city of Salinas since we have many, many, many employees who live in Salinas and commute over to Monterey,
sure.
That the benefit of widening 156, you have to look at all options. I've been very vocal about the fact that in the city of Salinas, we've had many discussions about a special tax, a general tax, a tax of some sort.
Mm.
And that it's most likely, if we continue, and we'll find out later today, stay tuned, how that is going to shape up and at what point do we actually have a discussion, and if so, when do we put it on the ballot? I've said it's most likely going to be in 2014 if we move forward with it. That being said, recognizing that the city of Salinas has some discussions going on about a tax measure, that it probably would not benefit the county to be actively and aggressively going after a tax measure at the same time. That's where that conversation ends.
Well, it sounds like a tax, and sounds like 2016, but not 2014?
It's not. There has been no decision made on any tax.
Keep us posted.
Part of the discussion is the widening of 156, and how do you fund that? Do you fund it with federal dollars? Do you fund it with state dollars?
Sure.
Do you fund it through a tax within the county? Do you fund it through tolling? Those are all topics.
Let's get a cup of coffee and talk about this.
Thank you. Why don't you two take some time and discuss this? Thank you. This last weekend, we had about 200 people from Korea here celebrating Korean Day, all members of our community, all that own businesses. They brought dancers. What I found rather unique was they brought a box, and on it said donation for the Philippines, and they made a rather substantial collection to give and to help the people in the Philippines. So it was quite interesting to see their generosity in helping the community. At the same time, Hartnell College had their announcements for their athletes in the past, and they've opened up a section that's going to list their athletes in the past that they've honored and nominated for future enshrinement into their Hall of Fame. This tomorrow afternoon, the Kauffman Foundation is going to graduate their first graduates, people that went to the entrepreneurship program. That should be interesting to see how we come out of that with future. And one other item I'd like to recommend to council members that like to go on junkets, if they've been described, is that when you return, I would love to see written reports so that we would have those available for future documentation and that we would have to assist when we plan or when we go to our directors that we're able to provide information. So I certainly think that that would be an excellent idea on your part and to turn those into the city manager so that when we direct staff to work that would be done efficiently. Thank you. So we're going to move on now. And the first item is going to be a guess what? I almost got away from the consent agenda. Okay, we're going to go to that. We have five items on the consent agenda. Does anybody want any item pulled? Starting with my council members to my left.
Yes. But hold on just a second. Item on the Cesar Chavez Park.
That's me too.
Item six.
I believe the items already pulled. Approval of minutes of October 8th and November 5th.
Those have been tabled, and we only have five items on the.
Thank you.
Councilmember McShane, to my right.
A comment on item number six, Cesar Chavez Park.
Comment. Four, five, and six.
Okay. Anyone from the audience that would like an item pulled, please speak. Okay. Anyone else? Seeing none, we will now come back to the council members, and we'll go to item number 4. Councilmember Barrera.
Mr. Mayor, I just wanted to make a comment, being that I'm your appointment to MST. Throughout the Monterey County, the busiest line is Line 41 with the Monterey Salinas Transit. And that's from this Metro Center, which is about half a block from here. And it goes all the way to the Al-Azhar Hartnell campus. And one of the things that we're doing to improve that is we're looking at all of our bus stops. Several of them have been vandalized. We're trying to figure out a way how to make it as comfortable as possible for our ridership, but we're having a difficult time. But right now, Monterey Salinas Transit is doing a great job. As a matter of fact, Councilmember Craig, McShane, and myself on Sunday, December 15th, we're hosting a holiday something. And MST, thanks to Councilmember Craig and Councilmember McShane, MST is providing 2 buses to the council members so we can take different residents to view different homes. So if you would like us to stop at your home, let us know. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, the next item we'll go to is item number 5. And I believe you have a comment or question on that, sir?
Yes, Mr. Mayor. It concerns me a little bit. I know it's $10,000, which is a lot of money for me. But we're getting ready to pay $10,000 for a meeting place. And, you know, we just rented out a big part of our city hall here for $1 a year. I mean, I was thinking, and it's a beautiful, what do we call this part of the museum or something or whatever it's called? You know, we should be able to get a meeting place here at City Hall somewhere. I mean, to pay $10,000, we can pay $10,000 and fix the slide at Eldorado Park. So, Mr. Peterson, I'd like to know why 307 Main Street, we're going to pay $10,000 for rent.
Sure. This is part of the downtown vibrancy study, and part of the public outreach commitment was to establish a place in downtown where the community could access us, learn what we're doing, where the community stakeholder meeting could continue to come together. We have been meeting in the Steinbeck Center, but that's subject to other uses. This is an area where we can do the work that we're doing, the studying that we're doing, post the information there, make it available to the community and easier access for downtown. It's an enhancement to the study process and encourages participation by the community and gives us a place to do our work.
Thank you.
Okay, we're going to move to item number 6 and we'll mix it up a little bit. We'll go to Councilwoman Lutz on item number 6.
So, Gary, this is why you don't like to see council members go to the National League of Cities. My question is, when we're looking at the wood chips that we're putting in, I was doing some research on the rubberized surface coverings that are more fully accessible, whether it be the shredded rubber or the pour-in-place rubber mats. Can we do that?
Well, carefully perused the numerous catalogs that you provided me with playground equipment, and looking at all the lovely pictures, beautiful pictures of playgrounds, there were 2 surfaces. There were wood chip surfaces, and there were the rubberized surfaces. We can always look at rubberized surfaces, although they come at a much, much higher cost, and twice we've had the experience in Salinas of those being set on fire. And they're petroleum-based, and they burn very hotly, just like a rubber tire would. So we have tried that. Central Park was created quite a mess. So gasoline was poured on it, and it was ignited. So that's not to say that someone couldn't light our wood chips on fire, but that was our experience with rubberized playground equipment. And we can revisit it, although, you know, I like to work with my maintenance folks, and they certainly have histories that, and this was very troublesome for them, and they would like to avoid doing that in the future, and have found, and we are well underway. As part of this, we'll be doing wood chips, but we also have other grants to do wood chips.
Okay. Well, and I realize that at this late date, it's probably hard to change, and that is a concern. But I think what we should do is look and see what other cities are doing, because I know that is moving towards the trend of the full accessibility. I see some cities have even just put in the artificial turf. I mean, as long as they can meet the fall factor.
And I did study very carefully the application at Tatum's Garden when it went in. I want to see what it looked like. Primarily, as we go forward, we can review this and be willing to try again. It's a cost factor, so you get a lot. It's much more costly. So
but let me ask you this: in spite of the cost, isn't there an obligation for us to meet the ADA requirements that we really need to be able to?
Not in all park equipment. A fully accessible. This is what makes Tatum's Garden so remarkable. It is not required that all playgrounds have that type of accessibility. It's very rare, in fact, to find one that does. And that's why Tatum's Garden is such an interesting process, because it's designed for all of that accessibility, including the surfaces. But I would say that that rubberized surface does make it more accessible. But there's also the issue of, as you saw in the equipment that you provided, it's a very different kind of equipment. So, but certainly we can look at that going forward. It's simply a matter of cost.
Okay. So I hope that we can follow through on just be starting to think about real accessibility.
And we are working on the slide.
Thank you.
We have, it's on our radar, it's been on our radar, and we're trying to figure that out as
Thank
we go
you,
forward.
Gary.
Sure.
Councilmember Barrera?
No, it was me. Or was it you? You were commenting on 6, too?
Or we're on 6, huh?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Okay.
Yes, thank you.
Okay.
I just want to say with this improvements, Mr. Peterson, was all this money from CDBG, or did we get was there a city staff member that was able to write a grant and we got some money from it?
This is CDBG. There is a process that begins tomorrow night at Cesar Chavez Library, where the Elizabeth and the library folks and the community folks got a $100,000 grant from the Packard Foundation to create an amenity for Cesar Chavez Park to be determined by the community. And we'll come in behind the work that we're doing and install that.
Yes.
Whatever that, provided it's something that we can install, yes, depending on what gets selected.
And if I may, Mr. Mayor, I would like to ask our city manager, it was my understanding that a city staff person wrote a grant and they got $100,000. I would like to reemphasize, every now and then, if it's possible to see the staff's name, you know that getting grants is difficult. It's hard. It's a lot of work. But to be able to say thank you, you know, to a specific individual, I would like to, again, request that, if possible, when we do have grants, that we can acknowledge the staff person for their good work. Thank you.
Okay, Gloria.
Okay. I want to support Councilmember Lutz on her comments. Again, the expense on the wood chips, and we're grateful, the community around that area, for the wood chips. But again, I would like to again stress that we look at the rubberized, because I know that there is some parks that do have rubberized in the city of Salinas. And I know that that's the future. If you look at other cities, it's rubberized. We have it in La Paz Park. It's all rubberized. So again, for safety reasons, I would like to support Councilmember Lutz's request. And again, we thank you for the wood chips and everything else that we're going to do at Cesar Chavez Park. Thank you.
Mr. Espindola.
Good evening. My name is Al Espindola. I just wanted to speak on item 6, basically in support of the work that's in front of you per the document. And also I'd like to thank Mr. Peterson, because we've had conversations about other than Cesar Chavez Park, but some of our parks in the north and northwest. I did a tour. There's 4 of us that call ourselves Friends of the Park. Seems like everybody wants to get involved on a committee. And we have Friends of the Library, so, and I was talking to our fire chief that it would be nice if we had a Friends of the Firemen. the fire department, because sometimes they're able to vocalize things that are you guys listen to and maybe move things along. But the park improvements within Salinas has always been something that I've always tried to advance to you people as best as I could, because I think without the open spaces and the ability of kids to have a place to play, then this new juvenile hall, the 120 beds, is not going to be enough. So I really support staff's recommendation on Cesar Chavez Park. And I think if you go to El Dorado Park, you'll see, as I did, the fix is I think worse probably than the slide. It's very a safety hazard. We saw two boys playing on the structure. We yelled at them, and they did get down. But these were young kids. I don't know that teenagers would listen to us if we yelled at them, but I think you really need to consider moving forward to try to do something to get that slide either taken out or replaced, because it's the way it's sitting, you're gonna probably end up with a lawsuit. Thank you.
Thank you. Do I have a motion?
Mr. Mayor, I would like to request that we can vote separate on number 5.
So move.
Okay. Do I have a motion on the rest of the item?
Move approval of the remaining consent calendar.
Okay. City Clerk, will you do roll call on all items except number 5?
So items 2 through 6 minus consent resolution item number 1 and number 5. Councilmember Barrera?
Aye.
Councilmember Castañeda?
Yes.
Councilmember Craig?
Yes.
Councilmember De La Rosa?
Aye.
Councilmember Lutz?
Aye.
Councilmember McShane?
Yes.
Mayor Gunter?
Aye.
Roll call on item number 5 for 307 Main Street license agreement. Councilmember Barrera?
No.
Councilmember Castañeda?
Yes.
Councilmember Craig?
Yes.
Councilmember De La Rosa?
Yes.
Councilmember Lutz?
Aye.
Councilmember McShane?
Aye.
Mayor Gunter?
Aye.
Motion passes.
We are now going to move to consideration item number 1, which is the Salinas Revenue Measure Feasibility Survey results and preliminary recommended next steps. We'll turn it over to our finance director, Mr. Pressey.
Thank you, Honorable Mayor and members of City Council. If you recall, back on August 13th, City Council authorized a revenue measure feasibility survey and to assess the viability of a voter-approved funding measure, and the City Council approved focusing on the research and the community outreach that would begin to explore two potential ballot measures. One would reduce and modernize the UUT, and the second is consider a new sales tax measure. So we have Jared Boygan and Brian Godby. Jared's with TBWB, and Brian is with Godby Research here tonight. And they've finished and culminated their feasibility survey. And they're here to present this material, and I'll go ahead and turn it over to Jared to lead in, and then he'll turn it over to Brian. Thank you.
Thank you, Matt. Council members, Mr. Mayor, thank you for having us back. I'm Jared Boygan with TBWB Strategies. It's nice to see you all. Brian's going to talk in just a couple minutes and walk everybody through the detailed results from the revenue measure survey. Just, you know, by way of background, obviously it's a continuation of a long conversation we've been having as council about how to meet some of the needs of the city as expressed by voters in the community. One thing that, as I know all of you know, but just for the member of the public to be aware, we had a tremendous amount of very constructive, thorough council member input into the survey that went to citizens. I'm hard-pressed to think of another example when there was so much thought and consideration and input given by every council member into a draft of a survey like this. So I want to thank you all for the time that you put into that. That was very valuable to us, and I think created a better research instrument. And I think you'll hopefully see some of that in the results. I don't want to take away, as Brian walks through the results, but then I'll circle back at the end and we can talk a little bit about conclusions and next steps. So.
Thank you, Jared, Matt, Mr. Mayor, members of the council. I'm Brian Godby with Godby Research, pleased to be here this evening to present the data from the survey. And let's see, it must be this, right? Okay, so I will jump right into it. To begin with, and as you know, this was a survey that you commissioned to look at potential voter support for a sales tax and a UUT modernization measure, to look at the type of tax, both general and special, to look at optimum tax amounts that we might put the sales tax on the ballot for, to test or prioritize projects and programs that the proceeds would fund, to look at both supporting and opposing arguments and see what the impact on voter support is there. And then, of course, there's a variety of demographic and behavioral characteristics that are built into the analysis that we have available to us as well. As you know, this was a telephone survey. The universe of voters that we sampled from were the 28,000 in round numbers, likely November 2014 voters in the city of Salinas. We were in the field from the middle of October on the 17th through the 26th. The average interview was 18 minutes long. We completed 600 interviews, and 43 of those were actually in Spanish. And the that leaves us with an error rate of plus or minus 4%. Any questions about methodology before I move on? Okay, great. To begin with, just to give you a high-level summary of what we found, and then we can get into the specific data, there is a strong support for a sales tax and a utility tax modernization, and there is a broad support of a broad range of services and facilities that those revenue measures might fund. They include public safety, after-school programs, street repair, neighborhood recreation centers, library hours, and senior services, among others. And you will see that the list is quite long and very broad. The citizens believe that nearly all of the city's funding needs are very important. And you'll see a list that I think is almost unparalleled in my research over the last 30 years, that there are so many things that are high priorities. For the voters. The voters believe also that reducing crime and making Salinas safer includes both a prevention component, like libraries and after-school homework assistance and youth programs, as well as the law enforcement, neighborhood policing, gang task force, and secure police force facilities. Both the general sales tax measures and the UUT test substantially above the simple majority required for passing a general tax measure. And while we look at, and you'll see in a moment in detail, both a 1 cent and a half cent sales tax, there really isn't a statistically significant difference between the two of those. They both have high levels of support. Because the support for a broad mix of services and facilities, the general tax, which covers everything, does actually better than a special tax, which is for a more narrow list of services and needs in the community. And finally, Jared and I recommend that the council consider moving forward and placing a 1 cent sales tax, general sales tax, on the ballot with the UUT modernization measure, and that you also continue with the public outreach prior to the council taking formal action. So that's a high-level assessment. Now let's step back a moment and look at the details. This is our first ballot test. One more page. There you go. This is our first ballot test of the 1 cent sales tax. And the way we did this, because it's difficult to ask too many taxes. So you wouldn't ask 1 cent and then half cent and then UUT and then do it all over again and then bring in the special tax. So we did what's called a split sample. So half of the respondents got a 1 cent sales tax, and another random half got a half cent sales tax. And then everybody got the UUT since there was only one rate there. What that does is it gives us the ability to compare without the confounding effects of different tax rates and to see what level of support we get for each tax rate. And that was one of the things that we talked about at the outset. So this is the 1 cent tax, 1 cent general tax. And you'll notice the wording that we used in the box on the right-hand side of the slide, and it is very specific. It fits into the 75-word framework that you're limited to, but it includes crime and gang prevention, neighborhood policing, fixing potholes, library park and recreation services for seniors, and other city services. So you see it is very clearly a general tax because it can do all of those different things. The way we ask this question is read that text and then say, would you vote yes or no on this measure? We then go the next step and say, is that definitely yes or probably yes? So it is correct to look at the disaggregated definitelys and probabilities, but it's also correct to look at the total yes, the total no, because that's the first way we ask the question. So in that context, you see we have 63% in round numbers yes, and 29% no, with only don't know at 8%. 63% is a great place to begin. It's a great place to finish for a general tax that only requires a simple majority. The next slide shows the other half of the coin, literally, and this is a half-cent sales tax. The wording is the same, but the difference is saying this is a half-cent. And here, again, using the same methodology, we can aggregate the probably and definitely responses. And so you see that the yes is 64% in round numbers, no is 28%, and don't know is 8%. So slightly higher, but statistically speaking, there's no difference between those two sets of responses. At that point in the survey, we then switched to the UUT modernization. Again, we've got the ballot question on the right-hand side of the slide. Here, we get 68%. On the yes side versus only 19% no. So again, a very, very strong margin. Now the next set of questions, and it was really a set because it was all these things that you see here and more that are on the next slide, were features of the measure. That is what we're gonna spend the money on. And the way we ask this question is we read each of these items of which you see a summary here, the questionnaire and top lines that you have available show the full wording, but it just doesn't fit on the slide, as you can see. We read the item in a random order, so it's not in the order you see here that we present it to the respondents, nor is it in any other fixed order. It's randomized, so we don't have a position bias built into the data. And what we do is we say, would you be more or less likely to support the measure? We then drill down another step and say, is that much more likely or somewhat more likely on either side of the equation? What you see here are the aggregate more likelies. And as I said at the outset, I think that you have one of the highest responses to this question that I've seen. As you can see here, there's 19 items that we tested that you might spend the money on, and every one of them is above 70%. More likely to support the measure based on that. This would all, from a statistical perspective, be tier one, which means that with a 4% and sometimes 6% error rate because of some split sampling we did, these are virtually the same from a statistical perspective, but you do have to put one thing in front of the other when you write a ballot question, so it's useful to see what the priority is even within that statistical test. The top five items, or even really the top 10 items, all range from 76% in round numbers up to nearly 80% and include keep schools safe from gangs and drugs, enhance anti-gang and law enforcement efforts, secure police facilities that protect safety of officers, keep streets from falling into disrepair, enhance anti-gang and youth violence prevention efforts, maintain after-school programs for children and teens, maintain and repair local streets and roads, which is just a different way of talking about what I mentioned earlier, keeping streets from falling into disrepair, enhance paramedic services and cut response time, repair aging recreation centers and keep them open, and fix potholes and streets. Again, another angle on the street repair. So those are the top 10 items, and those are all really 76% in round numbers, at least somewhat more likely to support the measure. That's great. We've had cities go forward where there's two or three things that are above 60%. You've got a whole handful that are well into the 70s. And I won't read the rest of the slide, but to belabor the point, this is a lot to work with.
And I'm sorry, Brian, just to interrupt briefly, but I think one good interpretation here is, consistent with the polling that we saw last year, these are all things your residents strongly would like to see, all areas where they'd like to see improvement. and they're willing to invest some money strongly, 70% or more of them, in all of these areas. So that's a way to interpret that.
Right. Thank you, Jared. And it is also a list that runs the entire gamut of city services. The next slide is the rest of the same question. This is tier two. Statistically speaking, they are different from what we saw on the previous slide. But four of these items are above the 66% level, and the other three are all positive, although at lower levels. And again, there's such a gamut of things to work with that you probably wouldn't even wind up talking about things this low on the list, realizing that this low is still really pretty positive. Now, the next set of questions are structured much the same way, except we introduce these as being statements that supporters of the measures might raise. And so as a result, it doesn't make sense that there is a less likely a side of this equation. So this is necessarily a little bit higher generally, although here it's about the same in terms of the level of support.